Okay, so yeah, when Nintendo released the Wii back in 2006, they had announced that they would sell retro games digitally. They called this service the Virtual Console. Anyway, when they made these titles available, the Super Nintendo games prevented you from starting the actual game if you didn't have a valid controller, leaving you stuck on a screen like this. But perhaps even more frustrating is that if you use GameCube controllers, every game is forced to use the same mappings. This means that for most games, you are stuck with a layout that's uncomfortable to play or is borderline unplayable. Super Mario World was the first title I bought from the Wii Shop channel, and it has always bothered me how such an important game could get released like this. It really feels like Nintendo wanted people to buy the stupid classic controller. And if that wasn't enough, the game volume is also ridiculously low. How did anyone enjoy these games like this? Well, that's the thing. The emulation is still pretty flawless, and the games are still as good as you remember. Perhaps. Unless the game you're playing is Super Empire Strikes Back. So, I do realize homebrew software is a thing, and that SNES 9X will run practically every game. But there's something about using the official emulator that's hard to describe. It just works, and it even has an electronic manual, I guess. It's too late anyway, I have already cuffed up a program that allows fixing up any BC title as long as you provide it with the uncompressed executable. I call it the SNES BC Booster. One curious thing is that I looked into adding standalone Wiimote support because many games can be played with just the Wii remote on its side. In fact, Nintendo released a few Super Nintendo games on disc, which supported the Wii Remote by itself. These were Super Mario All-Stars and the Kirby games featured in Kirby's Dream Collection. My idea was that since the Wiimote has to be read by the game in order to detect if the home button has been pressed, I figured if you manually find this value and the one for the emulated SNES inputs, you can sort of make a rough translation between them to create Wii Remote support. This works by adding more assembly code to the game. My tool has this feature, so you only have to provide the addresses and the desired mappings on a text file. But since this had some problems, for instance, it required people to have access to the Dolphin emulator in order to find the addresses. People also needed to have a GameCube controller connected, since the emulated inputs would not be read by the game if a valid controller didn't exist. Okay, but here's where it gets really good. While I was testing many titles for my program, I went ahead and tested all 74 US Super Nintendo Virtual Console titles. Yes, even the games that no one cares about, like Nobunaga's Ambition. I wanted to do this to see for myself that my program actually works for the various patches it supports. So while doing this massive testing, I found out that my GameCube remapping patch was not working on a few Square Enix titles. So when I went in to figure out the solution, I found some really interesting code. It seemed like there were mappings for an unknown controller. It was hidden behind a condition that was never getting met. I removed the if condition to force the code to always execute, and wouldn't you know it, I had just found the real, native support for standalone Wii remotes. This prompted me to adapt my existing code for setting key mappings from a text file, and testing each and every one of the 74 US titles again. Yes. Even Romance of the Three Kingdoms 4, Wall of Fire. I can guarantee that all 74 titles support the Wii Remote natively and can be easily patched with my SNES PC Booster program. Now, one last thing I'd like to talk about is the header check. The Heather check is a test done by the emulator that occurs in every title. For the early titles like Super Metroid, this function determines if SRAM needs to be saved. So if I skip this check, it will break saving in games that support it. But later titles got more use out of this test. They made it gradually more strict when it came to supporting a specific game. For example, they added additional checks for if the emulator's internal setting says SRAM is supported, but the ROM doesn't support saving, then it will crash. The checks seemed to get more aggressive. Eventually, they even checked for random hex strings in the ROM to ensure the game being played is the original one. One such title is Mega Man X2. For people not in the know, this game uses a special chip, so the only way to play it on the Virtual Console is to use the official release. But the sequel, Mega Man X3, also used the special chip but was never released on the Wii Virtual Console. By removing the Heather check, or specifically the code for the various hex string comparisons, it is now possible to play Mega Man X3 on the Wii Virtual Console. Now that's something you don't see every day. When it comes to Mega Man, we don't quite see each other eye to eye, but man, is this cool. I suppose the last thing to talk about is that pesky dark filter that some of the games have. I looked into this a lot. In fact, I was able to create a patch for certain games that I think no one had been able to fix before. For example, Super Mario All-Stars, Final Fantasy II, and Secret of Mana. But there were four titles that I wasn't able to figure out how the filter is getting applied. These were Super Return of the Jedi, Axelay, Wild Guns, and Super EDF. EDF, EDF. Since that Star Wars game is still part of my collection, I felt inclined to find the solution, so I took advantage of the filter used to reduce interlaced flicker. By following advice from Extremes, if you adjust this filter, it can be used to control brightness. So alongside SNES PC Booster, I include a code for this game specifically, to take care of its rather dark image. It's not the best solution, but it works. Well, I hope you enjoyed watching this, and if you want to check out SNES PC Booster, it's on my GitHub, compiled for Windows. This is Side Pocket, obviously. It's injected into the ignition factor, which is normally not possible without my SNES VC booster tool. My TV's a little strange. I like to call it the prismatic secret rare. Anyway, here we have the widescreen home menu. And we have the game, widescreen corrected, with a loud volume, and Wiimote support.